Pascal's triangle starts with a single one at the top, and every other number is created by adding up the numbers directly above it. To see an amazing pattern hidden inside here, let's color all the odd numbers green and leave the even numbers in dark blue. You can now see a pattern like Zelda's Triforce. Zooming out, we can see this pattern repeats and a fractal known as the Sierpinski Triangle begins to emerge. But actually, there are infinitely many other fractals you can create too. For example, if instead of even versus odd, you color based on divisibility by 3, we now see a different 3-color fractal. Another new fractal appears when you color based on divisibility by 4. And this is what it looks like when you color using divisibility by 5. In this video, I will explain how all these patterns appear in Pascal's triangle. There is actually just one simple fact about prime numbers that unlocks the whole thing. Once you understand it, you will directly see how these patterns copy themselves and repeat to create these beautiful fractals. To see how everything works, let's zoom back in and start at the beginning where the numbers were created in the first place. Let's create a 5-color fractal using these 5 colors as an example. We'll see later that the same mechanism that creates the fractal here works as long as the number of colors is a prime number. In our coloring, the color of each number is determined by its remainder when divided by 5. This is sometimes called modulo 5, or just mod 5 for short. We'll use this dark blue color to color in any number that is perfectly divisible by 5, like 0, 5, 10, 15, and so on. This green color is for anything that leaves a remainder of 1 when you divide it by 5, like 1, 6, or 11. Similarly, these other colors will represent remainders 2, 3, and 4. For each of these colors, it is easier to just remember the remainder, which is always a number between 0 and 4. We'll use this funny triple equal sign symbol to write down this idea of treating numbers with the same remainder as equivalent. We can now create Pascal's triangle like we originally did by adding up adjacent numbers to get the numbers in the next row. The first interesting thing that happens is in the fourth row, when we add 3 plus 3. This addition is the first time that we get something larger than 5. Because 6 leaves a remainder of 1, we color it in with this green color, just like a 1 is colored. In other words, thinking only in terms of remainders, we can write 3 plus 3 is equivalent to 1 mod 5. This is the great simplifying power of looking only at the remainders. We can simplify as we go to always make sure the numbers are between 0 and 4. For our purposes, we can completely erase the number 6 and literally just replace it with the number 1. All the calculations will work out the same. Filling in the rest of the fourth row, we see the interesting looking pattern 1, 4, 1, 4, 1. And on the next line, a minor mathematical miracle happens. All the numbers on the inside of this row are perfectly divisible by 5. Because these leave a remainder of 0, they all get colored in our dark blue color, and we can replace them with literally the number 0 for all our calculations. It is not a coincidence that this miracle row of all zeros happened exactly on the 5th new row. We'll see later in the video that in general, when you use P colors, you always get a row of all zeros in the Pth row. And this miracle row of all zeros is exactly the conditions we need for the pattern to perfectly repeat itself and create a fractal. To see the effect of these zeros, let's zoom out and think about what will happen just below this leftmost one in the next 5 rows. As we add up the numbers, we notice that we are repeatedly adding zeros. Since 0 plus 0 equals 0, we end up with an inverted triangle of all zeros in the middle here. And on the left-hand side, we get an exact identical copy of the first 5 rows of Pascal's triangle. It's exactly as if we restarted the whole construction again from the very beginning with a single 1 entry on top. On the right side, the same thing happens. We end up with yet another copy of these first 5 rows. This little 5x5 triangle pattern, which we've seen repeated 3 times so far, is like a little stencil that is stamped throughout Pascal's triangle. In the next few rows, the pattern will repeat itself again. Like before, we get a copy of the stencil under the left corner, and yet another copy under the right corner. In the very middle, something really exciting happens. We get a single 2 surrounded by all zeros. This is just like a new Pascal's triangle start, but with a 2 at the top instead of a 1. This means that what will spawn below here is like our stencil pattern, but with every single entry doubled. For example, the outside entries of this group are all yellow 2s. In fact, we've literally just multiplied every single entry by 2. You can also think about this as if our 5x5 triangles are adding together to give a doubled version. So it's like the sum rule for Pascal's triangle, but being applied to these larger 5x5 triangles instead of individual entries. In fact, we're just recreating Pascal's triangle again at this larger scale, using 5x5 triangles as the new object which is being added together. And this perfectly fits because of that miracle row of all zeros which appeared in row number 5. The pattern continues. And finally, we see that all in all, in the first 25 rows, we have just recreated the stencil pattern from the first 5 rows using these larger 5x5 triangles as the building blocks. The first 25 rows look exactly the same as the first 5 rows, but just zoomed out. This is exactly what a fractal is. It's the same pattern appearing, but at different scales. In the next row, our minor mathematical miracle strikes again. Like row number 5, row number 25 has all zeros in the interior. This row of zeros will enable the same phenomenon to continue again, using 25x25 triangles as building blocks. The pattern repeats itself at a 5x larger scale again. This repetition of the pattern at larger and larger scales is exactly why all the rows of Pascal's triangle are eventually covered. Hello and welcome to the live action part of the video. In this part, I'm going to answer the question, why are there zeros? Why are there zeros? And I mean these zeros that we saw in our stencil. So this stencil pattern for coloring Pascal's triangle with 5 colors based on divisibility by 5, we saw that this was the secret that really made the whole fractal work. That's why you get pictures that look like this, that are just big copies of this stencil pattern. And the thing that really made it work is this row of zeros that caused it to copy over and over again. Why are there zeros here? Well, having a zero here, this is the remainder when you divide by 5, that's exactly the same as having all multiples of 5 on the 5th row. And you can see when you look at Pascal's triangle, so here it is with no divisibility, these are the raw numbers, you can see something really interesting happen on the prime rows. So what do I mean by prime rows? I mean rows like the 2nd row, the 3rd row, the 5th row, the 7th row. And if you look at these rows, you'll see that in every row, so when n equals 2, the 2nd row, they're all multiples of 2. And when n equals 3, the 3rd row, they're all multiples of 3. And when n equals 5, the 5th row, they're all multiples of 5. And it works when n equals 7, 7, 21, 35 are all multiples of 7. And if you scroll down and go all the way to 11 to check the theory, you'll see they're all multiples of 11. 11, 55, 165 is 15 times 11. When you multiply by 11, you add the 1 and the 5 to get the 6. 462 is 42 times 11, and so on. So all multiples of 11 here on the 11th row as well. And this works for any prime number. So in Pascal's triangle, the statement we're going to prove is that the prime rows are multiples of p. So if n is prime, then the nth row is divisible by n. So all the entries in the nth row, okay, except for those two, the ones at the end, those are all multiples of the prime number. And that is why you get a row of all zeros. Zero means perfectly divisible, and that is the statement. So for prime numbers, it will always work. And that's why, the way, you can get this kind of picture for any prime number. In the introduction, I showed this picture, which is Pascal's triangle using divisibility by 3. And it's got the same kind of character as the one using divisibility by 5, because the 3rd row is all multiples of 3. Okay, so let's prove this statement that's in the box over here. And to prove it, we're going to use the formula for the kth entry on the nth row. So you tell me which row you're looking at and which entry you want to look at, how far into that row. We're going to start with k equals 0 all the way on the end and go all the way up to k equals n on the far side. And there's a nice formula for that. It is the binomial coefficient n choose k. And this is n factorial divided by k factorial times n minus k factorial. So a good example is when n equals 5, when k equals 2, here's k equals 0. K equals 1 and k equals 2, you get 10, and that is because 5 choose 2 is equal to 10. So that is an example of how this formula works. We're in the 5th row, 2 entries in, and this formula will show us why, if n is a prime number, it's going to be divisible. So if n is a prime number, then, so you have P choose K, and it's P factorial divided by K factorial N minus K factorial. I'm just going to take this P factorial and write it as P times P minus 1 factorial. So let's do a little bit of fixing up over here. I'm going to write this as P times P minus 1 factorial. And now, because P is a prime number, you have this P out in front. It is multiplying everything else. So therefore, it's going to be a multiple of P. Now, if you're quite clever, you might notice, okay, that's not actually true, because there is a denominator here. And maybe there's some cancellation. Maybe this P in the front is going to cancel out with some kind of P in this green denominator. But that cannot happen, because all the numbers here, all numbers here are less than P. So K is how far into the row you are. If you're really in the interior of the row, that's always a number less than P. And because P is prime, it has no factors that are less than P itself. So it's impossible for anything in this denominator here to have a factor of P in it that would cancel out with the P in the front. And that is why P being prime is crucial. It doesn't work in the non-prime rows, but for the prime rows, it really does work. And you have this P multiplying everything. And this stuff has got to be an integer. There's no other way for it to work. And that is why in Pascal's triangle, the pth row is always a multiple of P. And because the pth row is always a multiple of P, when you look at the remainder, when you divide by some number like 3 or 5, a prime number, you will get a row of all zeros. And that row of all zeros is what will spawn the entire Pascal's triangle fractal, like we saw in the main video. As a little bonus here, there's one extra way you can visualize this cool fractal. So you can draw it with colors like I did here, where you choose a different color for each of the divisibilities. But you can also visualize it using music and choose a different note for each of the divisibilities. So I guess you're not visualizing it, you're audioizing it, something like that. And this was actually done by a different YouTuber, Marc Evanstein, and he sent me this file, which is doing it for the case when you have 5 using the pentatonic scale. So I really like this one. I think it sounds really cool. So I hope you enjoyed.